मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, लास्ट टाइम वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट डीएनए रेप्लिकेशन। मूविंग फॉरवर्ड वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस टुडे अबाउट आरएनए, लिटिल बिट ऑफ आरएनए एंड टाइप्स ऑफ आरएनए। टू स्टडी अबाउट आरएनए इज रिक्वायर्ड बिकॉज नाउ वी आर नेक्स्ट गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट ट्रांसक्रिप्शन, मीन्स formation of RNA from the DNA, and later on this RNA will be translated into proteins. So there are different type of RNA that are involved in the formation of protein. So we must know about the structure of RNA and the functions that are performed by different RNA. So today we are going to talk about what RNA is, what different nitrogenous bases are present in RNA, and mainly about the types of RNA, their structure and the role played by the RNA in protein synthesis. So, RNA is ribonucleic acid, and it is also made up of ribonucleotides. Again, if we are talking about ribonucleotides, then these nucleotides are having a phosphate group, a ribose sugar, and nitrogenous bases. Now, if we compare with DNA, two differences are there. When we were talking about DNA, in DNA also phosphate group is present, but here ribose sugar is present, and in DNA deoxy ribose sugar is there. This is the difference, one difference between DNA and RNA. The second difference is in their nitrogenous bases. Here the nitrogenous bases are adenine, guanine, cytosine, and instead of thymine, uracil is present. So uracil is different, because in this one is different. While if we talk about DNA, we say in DNA adenine, guanine, cytosine and thymine are present. So there is difference in one pyrimidine. That is the difference between RNA and DNA. There is difference in the sugar that is present, and one of the nitrogenous base is also different in DNA and RNA. Now we know DNA is present as a genetic material in most of the organisms, while this RNA is also behaving as a genetic material, but it is present only in some of the viruses. And the viruses that are having RNA as their genetic material, we call them as retroviruses. Now this RNA, instead of it is behaving as genetic material only in few viruses, other than this, RNA is playing a very important role in protein synthesis. Without RNA, protein synthesis will not happen. And not only one, but lots of different type of RNA are involved in protein synthesis. So we are going to talk about the three major types of RNA that are important for the process of protein synthesis. These three are mRNA, tRNA and rRNA. These are three types of proteins, and if one of them is missing, that means protein synthesis is not going to take place. So all these three are important for the process of protein synthesis. And different DNA templates are responsible for the secretion or for the synthesis of these RNAs. Means these are not going to be synthesized from one DNA strand, one DNA template. Different DNA templates are required for the synthesis of these different type of RNAs. Let's talk about one by one. Firstly, let's discuss about mRNA. See, the word M is basically responsible for messenger RNA. That means mRNA stands for messenger RNA. Messenger simply means it is going to carry a message. That's why the name is given messenger RNA. Now, what kind of message is present in this RNA and where it is going to take this message and from where it is having coming this message? See, if we consider a cell, suppose I am taking a cell, nucleus of the cell, nuclear pores are present in the envelope, and over here DNA is present. DNA is present outside nucleus. Endoplasmic reticulum is present, and on the surface of endoplasmic reticulum, ribosomes are lying. This we already know. That is rough endoplasmic reticulum. Now the function is, the DNA that is present inside the nucleus, this is nucleus and this is the genetic material. Say I am writing DNA. This is rough ER and carrying ribosomes on their surface. Now this DNA is carrying all the biological genetic information that is going to code for a protein. So this DNA is having information for protein synthesis. But it is not able to synthesize protein. The function of protein synthesis is performed by ribosomes. The function they are performing is protein synthesis. So how protein synthesis is going to take place? The DNA is having the information for protein synthesis. This information will be supplied to ribosomes, and then by using this information, ribosomes are going to synthesize proteins. This is going to happen. But the DNA is not going to exit this nucleus. DNA is not going to come out. That means this DNA is going to send a messenger that is going to carry an information for a specific protein, where? To the ribosome, so that by utilizing that information, ribosomes can synthesize a protein. So what this messenger RNA is doing, this messenger RNA is carrying information from the DNA. This is messenger RNA, mRNA. This is having a information for a polypeptide, or you can say information for a for protein synthesis, or a message for protein synthesis, and it is going to give this information to ribosomes, and then by utilizing this information, ribosomes are going to perform protein synthesis. So because it is going to convey a message, it is carrying a message from DNA to ribosomes for protein synthesis, that's why we are calling it as messenger RNA. So DNA itself is not going to come out from the nucleus. It is going to give its information, code this information in form of messenger RNA. This messenger RNA will come out of the nucleus and it will deliver this information to ribosomes for the process of protein synthesis. This is what is going to happen in the cell during the process of protein synthesis. Now this, out of total RNA that is present inside the cell, this mRNA is constituting 5% of total RNA in a cell. And if we talk about the length of the mRNA, this is the longest RNA. Among all the types of RNA, mRNA is the longest one, and the length is not uniform, or we can say the length is not specified. The length is depending, the length of the mRNA is depending upon the length of the polypeptide protein for which it is coding for. So it can be if a protein is long, the length of mRNA will be long. If protein is short, the length of the mRNA will be short. So the length is going to vary depending upon the length of polypeptide it codes for. So length is always going to change. That's why it is also known as, because of difference in length that is found, it is also known as heterogeneous RNA, or in short we write down hnRNA. So mRNA is known as messenger RNA or heterogeneous RNA or hnRNA. The function is to carry information from DNA to the ribosomes for the process of protein synthesis. If we talk about the structure of this mRNA, how this mRNA looks like, so it is all again just like DNA, it is having a 5 prime and a 3 prime end, and on the 5 prime end this is how we show a mRNA. See, this is the 5 prime end of the mRNA and this is the 3 prime end of the mRNA. Now this 5 prime end of mRNA, it is having a guanine. It is known as 5 prime cap. It is having a guanine that is methylated. Methylated means CH3 group is attached on guanine. So this is a 5 prime cap methylated guanine is there at the 5 prime end. Now this 5 prime cap is followed by a small very short region. This is a non-coding sequence called leader sequence. It is non-coding. Non-coding means it is not going to code for any of the amino acid. So it is a non-coding sequence. The portion that is lying behind this non-coding sequence, this long bar, this is showing the coding region. Means this region is actually having the information to code for a protein. This is the whole sequence that is going to code for amino acid. The starting portion of this coding region always have, this portion is going to have an initiation codon. It can be AUG or GUG. These are initiation codons that are going to start the process of protein synthesis. I am repeating it again. This is the 5 prime end of mRNA and this is the 3 prime end of mRNA. The 5 prime end of mRNA is having a guanine that is methylated. This is known as 5 prime cap region. This 5 prime cap region is followed by a very small non-coding segment that is known as leader segment, and that is again followed by a coding region that is having a sequence for which amino acids will be added, because we know proteins are made up of amino acids. So here the information is present that is going for the addition of amino acids. Now the initial codons that are present over here are the initiation codons. Because of the presence of initiation codons, the process of protein synthesis will start or initiate. Now again the process of protein synthesis will terminate or stop because of the presence of stop codons. Over here stop codons are present, and when the machinery is going to reach at these stop codons, it is providing a signal that now protein synthesis has to stop. So this is how the codons are initiating and terminating the process of protein synthesis. The stop codons are UAG, UAA, UGA. These are the stop codons that are present over here. Means any one of them can be present and the process of protein synthesis will stop. Again, here a non-coding sequence is present, that is called trailer. And at the 5 prime end, poly A tail is present. What do we mean by poly A tail? Poly A tail simply means this region is followed by multiple A's. Adenine, adenine, a chain of adenine is present. That is the poly A tail. Now these structures, the 5 prime cap and the 3 prime poly A tail is important. They are protecting this messenger RNA from the hydrolytic enzymes. We know this messenger RNA has to travel from nucleus into the cytoplasm. So when it is going to come inside the cytoplasm, different hydrolytic enzymes are present. So there are chances of degradation of this mRNA. So these end regions are going to protect this mRNA from degradation. Another important thing is this region, the 5 prime region, has to come in contact with the ribosome, because protein synthesis will be done by ribosomes and information is present in mRNA. So this mRNA is going to interact with ribosome. So this portion is also helping in interaction with the ribosome. And when this mRNA will interact with ribosome, then protein synthesis will start. So this is how mRNA is present and different structures are helping in the process of protein synthesis. The second type of RNA that is required for protein synthesis is tRNA. The second one is tRNA, also known as transfer RNA. What this, if I talk about the number, or you can say total amount of tRNA that is present, it is 15% of total RNA present in a cell. And it is also the smallest one. Among all the RNA, it is the smallest one. First of all, we are going to talk about the function. Later on, we will see its structure. See, what it is known as transfer RNA. What it is going to transfer? It is going to transfer amino acids. It is responsible for the addition of amino acids. So the function of tRNA is, it will bind with the amino acids. Where these amino acids are present, they are simply present in the cytoplasmic pool. In the cytoplasm, amino acids are present and different tRNA are present for each amino acid. So we are having 20 amino acids. So different tRNA are present, they are specific for one amino acid. So a tRNA is going to bind with its specific amino acid and it is going to bring this amino acid to the ribosome. And later on, this amino acid will be involved in the formation of a polypeptide. So what this transfer RNA is going to do? It is going to bind a specific amino acid from the cytoplasmic pool . It will bring this amino acid to the ribosome . And later, after coming to ribosome, this amino acid will be involved in the formation of a polypeptide. Amino acid will be involved in formation of polypeptide. So this is the function of tRNA, transfer RNA. Now if we see the structure of transfer RNA, there was a scientist who explained the structure, R.W. Holling, in 1965, and he explained its structure and said that it is showing a clover leaf like model. How this clover leaf like structure is appearing? Because the strands of tRNA, they are going to interact by themselves by hydrogen bonding, and they are forming. Some portions will show double stranded structure and some portions will appear like loop. So if we see the complete structure, it is giving a clover leaf like appearance. So let's see how this tRNA is appearing. This is how the structure of tRNA is looking like. These are the loops that are formed. And this double-stranded structure is formed because of the hydrogen bonding between these base pairs. That's why it is giving a double-stranded like appearance. Now if we see its direction, this is the 3 prime end of the tRNA. And this 3 prime end is having a CAA chain. And this CAA chain is over here having a free OH group. So this is appearing like a CAA tail. And it is having this portion, the free 3 prime end is having a OH group. Now this OH group is going to bind with the COOH group of a amino acid. That means this 3 prime end is responsible for the binding of the specific amino acid. So I can say it is a amino acid binding site. This is the amino acid binding site. Because we know for the purpose of formation of bond, there is requirement of a free functional group. So here OH is group present, and this OH group is going to bind with COOH of a amino acid. So bond formation is going to take place, and this tRNA is going to carry a amino acid. Now this is the 5 prime end, the lower end that is present. This 5 prime end is having nucleotides, and these nucleotides, suppose this is the mRNA. Over here, this 5 prime end is going to interact with the mRNA. It is going to interact with mRNA, and we know mRNA is having the information. It is going to carry codons. See, this is how the codons are present on mRNA. Now, this side, this loop is known as anticodon loop. Means this loop is again having codons, means nitrogenous bases complementary to the sequence that is present on the mRNA. Say G, G, C is lying here, and it is going to interact with these codons that are present over mRNA. That's why it is known as anticodon loop. There is an interaction that is going to take place in between the anticodons that are present on tRNA and codons that are present on mRNA. And this interaction helps in formation of a peptide bond between in the polypeptide. Now this is known as D loop. This D loop is known as enzyme site. Why it is known as enzyme site? Because this loop is responsible to facilitate the binding of amino acid. It is a enzyme. Here enzyme is going to interact, and this enzyme is responsible. Later on we will see, talk about the enzyme also. This enzyme is helping in the formation, or you can say helping in the binding of this amino acid over this 3 prime end. That's why it is known as enzyme site. This one that is present over here, the T-Si loop, this is responsible for the interaction with the ribosome. That's why it is known as ribosomal site. So these different loops are performing different functions. Repeating it again, it is showing a clover leaf like model because of the hydrogen bonding, intra hydrogen bonding between the strands. So the strands which are showing hydrogen bonding are appearing double stranded, and where hydrogen bonding is not taking place, there are appearing showing loop like appearance. The 3 prime end is going to accept amino acid because here a free OH group is present. That's why it is known as amino acid binding site. The 5 prime end is known as anticodon loop because it is carrying the anticodons, and these anticodons will be complementary to the codons that are lying on the mRNA. Here also two loops are formed. This loop is responsible. Here the enzyme present is responsible for the binding of amino acid on the 3 prime end, and this loop is responsible for the interaction with the ribosome, because I earlier told you that this tRNA is going to bring the amino acid to the ribosome, because protein synthesis has to take place inside the ribosome. So this is how tRNA is appearing like, and this tRNA is showing lots of diversity because we are having different amino acids. So to bind with different amino acids, different tRNA are present in the cell. Depending upon the codon that is present over here, that will specify that which tRNA is going to bind over here. This tRNA is having the anticodons. For this codon, that means it is going to interact over here, and the amino acid which it is carrying, this amino acid will be added to the polypeptide chain. So this is how the tRNA is functioning. Now the third type of RNA, that is important, is rRNA. The third one is rRNA, and it is also known as ribosomal RNA because it is a part of ribosome. If we see the structure of this rRNA, it is highly coiled structure. It is going to coil, and these rRNAs are not freely present. These rRNA are associated with proteins. They are associated with different type of proteins, and they are forming the ribosomes. We have said that ribosomes are ribonucleoproteins. Why we are saying so? Because in ribosomes, RNA and proteins are associated with each other. So the RNA that is involved in the formation of ribosomes is rRNA. If we see or talk about ribosomes, these ribosomes can be freely lying in a cell in the cytoplasm, or they can be binded on the surface of endoplasmic reticulum. These ribosomes, if we see the difference in prokaryotes and eukaryotes, the function is going to same. That means in prokaryotes as well as in eukaryotes, the ribosomes are involved in the process of protein synthesis. But if we talk about their size, in eukaryotes, the size is going to be big, and it is ATS. While in prokaryotes, the size is small and it is 70S. And if we talk about their number, their amount, they are constituting or they are present in 80%. This means all around the RNA, all over RNA that is present inside the cell, 80% of total RNA is ribosomal RNA, or you can say rRNA. Now let's see the structure of ribosomes, that which subunit of ribosome is having which different type of rRNA. Here we are going to show about prokaryotes and eukaryotes. See, ribosomes are composed of two subunits, largest subunit and smaller subunit. And this is how they are arranged. This is the larger subunit, and on its base, the smaller subunit is present. And there is difference, again, because size is different, so there is difference in the larger and smaller subunit of prokaryotes and eukaryotes. If we talk about the larger subunit of eukaryotes, it is 60S, and smaller subunit is of 40S. If we talk about prokaryotes, the larger one is 50S and the smaller one is 30S. This is the larger subunit of ribosome, and this is the smaller subunit of ribosome. Now, different rRNA and proteins are associated with these larger and smaller subunits. If we talk about the 60S subunit of eukaryotes, it is having 28S rRNA, 5.8S rRNA, and 5S rRNA associated with 45 different basic proteins. These are different proteins that are associated with these rRNA, and they are making the larger subunit. Now, if we see the 40S subunit, this 40S subunit is having 21S rRNA, it's 18S rRNA, and it is associated with 33 different basic proteins. If we see the difference in 50S rRNA, this 50S rRNA is having 21S rRNA, 5S rRNA, and that is associated with 34 different basic proteins. The smaller subunit is having 16S rRNA, and it is associated with 21 different basic proteins. So these are the different rRNAs that are present and the number of proteins that are associated with them. Now, from these, the important one is the 18S rRNA that is present in smaller subunit in eukaryotes, and the 16S rRNA that is again present in the smaller subunit of prokaryotes, they are responsible for the interaction with the mRNA. That means the smaller subunit is going to interact with the mRNA. Firstly, it is going to interact with mRNA, then over there the larger subunit is going to place, means initially they are separated from each other. In cytoplasm, the smaller and larger subunits are present separately. But when a mRNA is going to interact with the smaller subunit, then its interaction is going to facilitate the binding of larger subunit over the surface of smaller subunit. This is how it is happening during the process of protein synthesis. Now, and this 5S rRNA in the larger subunit of eukaryotes and 5S rRNA in the smaller subunits of eukaryotes, they are going to bind with tRNA. Over here, tRNA, this is 23S. over here tRNA, with these rRNA units, the tRNA is going to bind. That means mRNA is going to interact with the smaller subunit and tRNA is going to interact with the larger subunit. Now we are having all the three type of rRNA. mRNA interact here, then ribo rRNA plus tRNA. All these three are going to interact and they will be involved in the process of protein synthesis. Other than these three type of RNA, there are lot more different type of RNA which are present in small amount and they are also playing some important roles in the process of RNA. But we are not going to, in the process of protein synthesis, but we are not required to talk about them. So we have just discussed about the three important type of RNA which will be played, going to play important role during the process of protein synthesis. And in next class, we will see the process of transcription, how RNA synthesis is going to take place on a DNA template.